The Rangers have no heart. The Rangers have no toughness or grit. We are busting some of the biggest myths surrounding the New York Rangers and also taking a look at the long-standing myth of the President's Trophy being cursed.
You're Locked On the New York Rangers, your daily podcast on the New York Rangers. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Welcome back, Blue Shirts fans, to episode number 1032 of the Locked On New York Rangers podcast. I'm your host, John Chick. Just want to thank you guys, as always, for making Locked On New York Rangers your first listen every day. We are free and available on all platforms, including YouTube. And today's episode of Locked On New York Rangers is brought to you by Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code Locked On for $20 off your first purchase. And we are, of course, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. So something a little bit different here today. You know, the Rangers, obviously, they're going to be going to the playoffs. We're coming down the home stretch here. And obviously, you know, we'll have a little mini subdued celebration when the Rangers officially do clinch their playoff spot. You know, obviously, they've got bigger fish to fry than just that. But it's always a nice little moment when your team, you know, for sure is making it to the playoffs. One thing I wanted to do here today, though, again, something a little bit different. We're going to be taking a look at some myths surrounding the New York Rangers and kind of debunking a couple of them, because, you know, there's fans that would have you believe that the Rangers are just a flat out bad team and just ignore the facts that, you know, they actually have the inside track to the President's Trophy as of Monday afternoon. And there are things you can always critique. There are things you can, you know, pick at, and they could be better in this area, or that player needs to be a little bit better, or that guy needs to step up, whatever the situation might be. But I want everybody, just for a second, do me a favor, consider this fact. The Rangers right now have the best record in the NHL. Just let that sit. Let that marinate for a second. It's been an awesome season. It's been a lot of fun. And again, you can be nervous about certain aspects of their game, or you might think that something might not translate to the playoffs. That's all well and good, and I'll at least hear you out there. But I hope that Ranger fans are at least getting some fun, some joy out of this situation. I think the vast majority are, but you guys know how it is. There's certain fans that are just never happy, and everything is all doom and gloom. But yeah, the way the Rangers, you know, line up right now, tied with the Canucks with 98 points, but both teams have played the same amount of games, and the Rangers have two more wins than the Canucks. So like I said, the inside track to the President's Trophy. We're going to talk about the President's Trophy a little bit later in today's episode as well. We're mostly going to be debunking Ranger myths. We've got one about the President's Trophy as well. But the first, you know, kind of go-to thing that Ranger naysayers, you know, like to throw out there, whether it makes any sense or not, is this idea that the Rangers have no heart. I saw a comment in a recent episode in the YouTube section where they had just lost. I think they lost to Tampa Bay. It was after the Lightning game. And somebody left a comment that was something along the lines of, why do they not even care about winning the division? Now, mind you, when this comment was left, the Rangers, even after this loss, I believe were 16-5-1 or 16-4-1 in their last however many games, you know, give or take a game in either direction. So I guess losing a game to a team that, by the way, has won two Stanley Cups in recent history and been to the finals three times in very recent history, that equates to just not caring about the division. God help us if a team actually just beats the Rangers straight up. To me, losing a game against a good team and not going 82-0, that does not equate to not caring. I think the Rangers do care about winning that division. I think for sure they're going to want to prioritize being healthy and making sure everybody's ready to go for the playoffs. But it's nice to win the division. It's nice to have home ice for as long as you can have it. And I do think that'll be a goal for the Rangers down the stretch here. Going to be a great race between them and the Canes. But again, this idea that the Rangers have no heart, let's really look at this. Let's really examine this. So a stat that was on the broadcast the other night at the time was that the Rangers had 21 come from behind wins on the season. And that's now 22 because they were down 2-0 to the Panthers. They came back and won that game. That mark, again, 22 come from behind wins, is third in the NHL. Only Colorado and Dallas have more come from behind wins. Now, does a team with no heart typically rack up? Let's try that again. Okay. Does a team with no heart typically rack up that many come-from-behind wins in one season, third in the league, 22 overall, probably another one or two coming down the pipe here. You know, we'll see how it goes. But that, to me, does not sound like the mark of a team that has no heart. I saw somebody else say that, you know, it was their first, comeback where they were down by multiple goals at home this season. Okay, fine. But keep in mind, Rangers are a really good team. They win a lot. And how often are they falling behind by multiple goals at home? It doesn't really happen that often. I don't have the exact number in front of me. But regardless, you know, when you have the kind of season the Rangers are having, you're not typically in a position where you're down by multiple goals at home. Doesn't happen really all that often. So, yeah, again, all this to me is evidence that the Rangers are quite the opposite of a team with no heart, a team with a lot of heart, a team that fights back and does not give up. We've seen them score dramatic game-tying goals, game-winning goals, go-ahead goals very late in the third period. There have been a couple times where they've had their goalie pulled and been able to tie the game. Lafreniere had one very early in the season. There have been a couple, you know, I think that outdoor game against the Islanders is obviously going to stand out. Because they were down by two goals there, tied it, sent it into overtime, and won this most recent game against the Panthers. Now, it wasn't like super, super, super late in the third period, but the Panthers had just scored with about 4 minutes to go, and then Panarin tied it up with about 3:30 to go. So, I mean, talk about showing some heart and answering back and not getting dejected, getting the game into overtime, and ultimately winning it in a shootout. Some other evidence as far as the Rangers having heart. We can turn the page back to two seasons ago. Now, obviously, some players have come and gone since that time. But I looked at the roster, the Rangers from 2 years ago, that playoff run that they had, you know, all the way to the Eastern Conference Final. They still have six forwards, six defensemen, and one goalie on that team from 2 years ago. That team fell behind 3-1 to the Penguins. Everything was all doom and gloom. The Rangers were absolutely embarrassed in games 3 and 4. Igor Shesterkin got pulled out of both those games. What did the Rangers do? They came back and won that series. And not just came back and won that series. They were down by 2 goals in game 5, came back and won it. Down by 2 goals in game 6, came back and won it. Down by a goal with 5 minutes to go in game 7, tied it, sent it to overtime. Panarin wins the game. So the Rangers advance past the Penguins in what I think is the greatest 3-1 comeback in sports history. That's a topic we'll dive into deeper on a future episode for sure. Maybe that's like an off-season kind of an episode. I do want to do a deep dive on that eventually. But again, plenty of evidence to suggest that this team has a lot of heart. And then look at the second round of the playoffs. You got the Carolina Hurricanes. Everybody thinks they're going to run over the Rangers. You know, Paul Bissonnette tweeted something out about that. And then we were all letting him have it when the Rangers won that series. But Rangers go down 2-0 there. Tie the series. They go down 3-2 there. They tie the series again. They win it in game 7 on the road. And, you know, to me, that's not the mark of a team that doesn't have heart. And I know some people, you know, the flip side of that might be, well, they were up 2-0 against Tampa and they lost. That's true. I mean, facts are facts. But, you know, you're going up against Tampa Bay Lightning, who had won the two previous Stanley Cups. That's not the kind of, you know, typical team that, you know, you're really in the driver's seat when you're up 2-0. And then last year, hey, I'll admit that was a debacle. Obviously, they destroyed the Devils in the first 2 games of that series, and it just didn't go their way after that. Obviously, I was really upset with that team when that happened. I don't think that's going to happen again this season, because far more often than not, when the Rangers are in the playoffs, in big games, they've shown a lot of evidence that they do play with a lot of heart, and they are a mentally tough team, and a team that, you know, will get it done more often than not in crunch time. So yeah, again, I don't know where that idea comes from. Every time they lose a game, there's a certain amount of Ranger fans that it's because they have no heart. Not going 82-0 does not mean that the team has no heart. I just want to bust that myth right out of the starting blocks here, because, you know, I'm not sure where that idea really comes from. And look, all this is not to say that the Rangers are guaranteed anything this year. You know, obviously, you get to the playoffs, and you guys know how unpredictable it can be. You know, they can go on a Stanley Cup run, or they can be done in the first round, or anything in between. But again, I think the number one reason why the Rangers won't win a Stanley Cup this year, if they don't win a Stanley Cup this year, is not because, oh, they have no heart. It's because winning a Stanley Cup is obviously very, very difficult to do. For my money, the most difficult championship to win in all of professional sports. But yeah, I'm not buying this idea, this myth here that the Rangers do not have any heart. I think there's plenty of evidence to the contrary that suggests that they actually do have quite a bit of heart. But We're keeping everything rolling in just a second. Got a couple other myths to debunk here. I want to talk a little bit about the idea that the Rangers don't beat good teams. Like I said, I want to highlight the President's Trophy a little bit later because the Rangers are obviously in the running for that. We'll get to all that good stuff in just a second. But first, definitely would like to let everybody know that today's episode of Locked On New York Rangers is brought to you by Sleeper. We are coming down the home stretch of the season, Ranger fans, and the Rangers have basically been on top of the Metro Division from coast to coast. But regardless of where we are in the current standings, I want to remind you that you could win big by playing daily fantasy hockey on Sleeper, the official daily fantasy app of the Locked On NHL Network. Sleeper is our number one choice for daily fantasy sports and especially daily fantasy hockey, because with Sleeper, you can win 100 times your cash in daily fantasy hockey contests. All you have to do is pick whether studs like Panarin or Igor or Kreider or Lafreniere will record more or less than their Sleeper projections for things like goals, assists, saves, plus minus, and more in a given game. To win 100 times your bet on Sleeper, you need to correctly predict the outcome of 8-player stats. You heard me, Ranger fans. You can win 100 times your money playing daily fantasy hockey with Sleeper. So start paying attention and nail your picks so you can start winning big. Use promo code LOCKEDONNHL and you will get up to a $100 match on your first deposit. Terms and conditions apply. That's code LOCKEDONNHL. See Sleeper's terms of use for details and locational availability. All right. Are you watching Fox Sports or ESPN on your TV all day? Have to turn down the volume with all that shouting? Make the switch to Locked On Sports today, a free 24/7 streaming channel programmed for you every day to bring you the biggest stories without all the screaming. Locked On Sports today brings you can't-miss analysis, opinions, and news streaming 24/7 on YouTube on the free Amazon Fire TV channels app, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team every day. All right, so let's go ahead and keep going, busting some of these myths here as it pertains to the New York Rangers. And there's one that has kind of sprouted up a little bit recently. You know, I've seen a couple people suggest this, the idea that the Rangers don't beat good teams. Yes, they do. They beat a lot of teams. They beat some good teams. They beat some mediocre teams. They beat some not so good teams. They have a record of 47-20-4. So in total, even with the best record in the NHL, they do have 24 losses when you combine regulation losses and the overtime losses. And there are certain fans that will find an issue with every single one of those losses. And it just not possible that the Rangers can just get outplayed on a certain night or even outworked. You know, any loss is unforgivable to a certain contingent of fans. Because this is what I see. Anytime they lose to a team that's not so good, like say they lose to the Blue Jackets. Obviously, you're the Blue Jackets for a team that's been kind of in the basement all season. They do seem to play the Rangers tough and give them some issues. So, you know, the Rangers struggle against the Jackets or they lose to the Jackets and it's like, oh my God, how could you lose to them? They're terrible. They're in last place. The only thing they're, you know, competing for is the first pick in the NHL draft, right? So then, you know, they lose to a good team. And it's like, oh, man, like they lose to the Panthers. They've lost 2 out of 3 to the Panthers this year. So we'll use them as an example. And it's like, oh, my God, they can't beat the good teams. All they do is beat up on the weak teams. Not all of these things can be true. And I just want to kind of illustrate my point as it pertains to the Rangers not being able to beat, you know, the really good teams, the really elite teams, or at the very least teams that are looking like they're going to be in the playoffs. Let's go in reverse order from March back to the start of the season in October and see some of the teams that the Rangers have beaten this season. So March, Panthers, Bruins, Canes, all pretty good teams. Wouldn't you agree? I think that's fair to say. February, the Flyers, the Stars, the Islanders. Now the Islanders, I think right now they might be on the outside looking in, but they were hot at the time. And obviously it's a rivalry game. So again, we'll start this one over. February, you got Flyers, Stars, Islanders, Lightning, and Avalanche. 5, you know, really good teams and a couple of cup contenders in there as well. Now, January, we know was terrible. The Rangers did not play well at all. It's their only bad month of the season. Every other month has been very, very good. I would say the best team, the Rangers didn't win much in January. That's, you know, we'll be honest about that. I'd say the best team they beat in January was probably the Capitals. But if you go back to 2023, you know, way back in the day here, you go to December. In December, the Rangers beat the Lightning, the Caps, the Leafs, the Bruins, and the Kings. And again, there might be a team in there, you know, maybe the Caps you're not so sold on, and they might not necessarily be a playoff team, and you don't consider them a top elite team, but it's still a team that at least is good, if unspectacular, you know, having a decent season. And I just mentioned four other teams that looks like for sure will be in the playoffs. And then in November, the Rangers beat the Bruins, the Flyers, the Wild, and the Canes. And in October, they beat the Jets, Canucks, and the Oilers. And all three of those were on the road. So this idea that the Rangers don't beat good teams, again, I'm just not really sure where it comes from. Obviously, there have been games where they've lost. You know, they lost to Tampa Bay not too long ago. You know, the Panthers had their number earlier in the season. They beat them twice. But, yeah, I mean, they swept the Bruins. You know, I don't really see a team that the Rangers can't possibly beat. I think the Panthers would be very, very difficult in a best-of-seven series. But, hey, that's a good problem to have because that means both teams are in the Eastern Conference Finals. So we'll cross that bridge when we get to it, if we get to it. But, again, the Rangers, they do beat good teams, and they do it quite often. Also, one other thing I want to do here while we're talking about, you know, beating good teams and losing to bad teams and all this stuff. The Rangers, you know, when they do lose to bad teams, you see some people kind of panic and like, oh my God, how could you lose to the Blue Jackets, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So I just want to do a quick list to kind of alleviate everybody's concerns. The Vegas Golden Knights last year won the Stanley Cup. Here's a list of some of the teams that they lost to, and it's not pretty. So the Flames, the Blues, the Sharks, the Canucks. Now, the Canucks are very good this year, but they were not very good last year at all. So they're on the list. The Penguins. It's just fun putting the Penguins on a list like this. But they lost to the Penguins. They lost to the Islanders, the Sabres, the Ducks, the Red Wings, the Coyotes, the Islanders, the Blackhawks, and the Flames once again. So, again, no matter what team you are, this very, you know, competitive league, even the bad teams, they're going to beat a good team on any given night. And, you know, a good team can beat another good team, can lose to a bad team. This is all to say that this stuff kind of fluctuates throughout the season. You'll see the Rangers beat some awesome teams. You'll see them lose to some not so good teams, but none of that is really unique to the Rangers. That's just the way the league is. And I don't think that the Rangers losing this game to this team back in November or beating this team in February, I don't think it's really all that cause for concern. Another myth is that the Rangers are going to be in trouble in the playoffs because they rely too much on their power play. There was a stat. I want to, again, bring our attention back to this Ranger-Panther game that just happened. Of course, the Rangers winning that game in the shootout. The stat showed which teams in the NHL score the highest percentage of their goals on the power play. And, of course, the Rangers were pretty high on this list. They were number five overall at about 23%. By contrast, though, the Panthers, who everybody agrees is an elite team and could really make a lot of noise come playoff time, a bona fide Stanley Cup contender. I don't think anybody really argues against that when it comes to the Panthers. The Panthers, so far this season, have scored a higher percentage of their goals on the power play than any other team in the NHL. And again, everybody says they're scary, they're deep, they're physical, they're tough. They went to the finals last year. They can get back again this year. They, at least going by that stat, rely on their power play more than the Rangers do. Now, does anybody hear that and think that, like, the Panthers aren't a serious contender in the playoffs just because they score a lot on their power play? You know, if the Rangers are vulnerable because of a supposed over-reliance on their power play, then the Panthers are even more so. And, of course, you know, the Rangers, there's times where that has been true in the past, where I think the Rangers, certainly earlier this season and in seasons past, you know, it feels like there's times where they're just kind of waiting around for their next power play chance, and we'll just score when we have the man advantage. But that hasn't been the case recently. You know, the Rangers went through a stretch in February. I mean, to begin with, they went 11-1 in the month of February, right? They had a stretch there, though, where they were like 11 for their last 66 on the power play. So obviously the power play wasn't clicking at that time, and the Rangers were winning in spite of it. And I said at the time that, you know, you don't want to see the team slump in any aspect of its game, but maybe it was a blessing in disguise. Maybe that was just a good thing for the Rangers. The power play wasn't working, and they had to find ways to win games in other ways, and they did that. They went 11-1 through February. So, you know, the Rangers are a really good power play team. They've been in the top five, top seven all year. I think they're like six right now. I'm not going to look at a really good power play as a bad thing. You know, that's a weapon for the Rangers. They're obviously very dangerous when they do have the man advantage. Now, will they have to score some even strength goals in the playoffs? Yeah, absolutely, 100%. But don't look at something the Rangers do well and twist it into a bad thing. You know, they are very dangerous on the power play. And they do have a lot of weapons there. And even the second power play unit, I think, has probably looked better recently than it has probably for the entire season. I know their ice time is limited, but it feels like they've been a little more dangerous and have put a couple goals in the net, you know, during various power play opportunities. So, yeah, as far as the over-reliance on the power play for the Rangers, again, it's been there at times, but I don't think it's something that going into the playoffs is all that much of a negative. You know, again, it's a good power play. Be happy about it. Feel good about it. So anyway, we're going to keep everything rolling in just a second. We're going to turn our attention to one other myth surrounding the Rangers and also take a look at the President's Trophy, the history of the President's Trophy, and try to determine whether it actually is cursed. And we will be doing that in just a second. Okay, let's go ahead, keep everything rolling here. So another myth about the Rangers, you hear this floated every now and then, as well as it, they have no toughness, right? Go up to Matt Rempe and try telling him that the Rangers have no toughness. The Rangers, you know, hits aren't the be-all, end-all when it comes to physicality and toughness, but to me, it's always a good place to start to kind of take a look at that stat. Rangers right now, seventh in the NHL in hits per game with 24.63. The only teams with more hits per game than the Rangers are the Panthers, the Bruins, Leafs, Predators, Islanders, and Canucks. And there's some good teams in there, some bona fide Stanley Cup contenders, Rangers included, by the way. I will say that stat has kind of flipped since last year. You know, last year, everybody was saying, well, the Rangers aren't physical enough, and that's why they got bumped out in the first round. And maybe there was some truth to that. I think there were bigger reasons than that. But, you know, the point I made at the time, once the playoffs kind of unfolded and we saw, you know, Vegas against Florida in the finals, and we saw all these other teams go on some pretty deep runs, a lot of the last couple of team standings, were not very high on hits per game. So physicality is nice and it helps and everything. But as I said last year, they don't just give the Stanley Cup to the team with the most hits. Obviously, you got to excel in a lot of other areas of the game as well. But for everybody that thinks, you know, the Rangers aren't physical and, you know, they back down and they're soft or whatever word you want to throw out there, again, seventh in the league in hits per game. So, again, there's evidence to the contrary as it pertains to the Rangers. You know, toughness, physicality, grit, sandpaper, use whatever word you want to use. I think you get the idea. I also mentioned Rempe a second ago. When it comes to toughness on this team, would anyone consider any of these following players to not be tough? I mean, you got Rempe, you've got Jacob Trouba, Ryan Lindgren. They're both hurt right now, but they'll be back. Trouba for sure, and then Lindgren hopefully before the playoffs start. But you got, again, Rempe, Trouba, Lindgren, Will Cooley, Braden Schneider, Barclay Goodrow, Vincent Trocheck. I mean, do these guys not have any toughness? Do these guys not stick their noses in there? Do these guys not mix it up? Do these guys not play physical? Do all these guys shy away from blocking shots or extracurriculars after the play? You know, again, going back to this Panthers game, and I know I keep doing this, but I think it's a very good barometer because, again, a lot of people coming into the season, and certainly as the season has progressed here, the Panthers are at or near a lot of people's lists as far as, you know, most likely to at least make it to the finals, if not win the Stanley Cup. Panthers lead the NHL in hits per game. The Rangers, when they played them, out-hit them 28-24. And again, it's just one game. You know, it's not an enormous sample size here, but as far as, you know, racking up hits, they were right there with the team that leads the league in hits per game. And something else about the Rangers, and I don't know that this was true as recently as, say, like 3 years ago, when I think this team was lacking a little bit of thump, a little bit of grit, a little bit of nastiness. You know, I think there was some truth to that in the past. But this Ranger team doesn't back down from anybody. You know, you see them going at it with players of the Bruins, players on the Panthers, these teams that are kind of known for their physicality and their toughness. And, you know, the intensity has been up a tick the last handful of games here because the Rangers are playing some other bona fide Stanley Cup contenders and the playoffs are right around the corner and everybody knows that. And the physicality is up and the stuff after the whistle is up as well. But does anybody ever see the Rangers when stuff goes down following a whistle? Well, you know, sometimes in front of one net or the other, does anybody see the Rangers like shying away from that and not wanting any part of that? I mean, they're all, every single one of them is always sticking their nose in there. Now, there's certain players on the Rangers that, of course, look to do that more than others. There's certain players on the Rangers that are more equipped to do that than others. But does anybody see a player on this team that when things go down after the whistle, that they're kind of backing away and they don't want any part of it? I mean, even Igor Shesterkin is in the middle of these scrums half the time anymore. So again, the idea that they lack toughness, grit, sandpaper, blah, blah, blah. I don't see that either. I think they do have a lot of that. Are there teams with slightly more? Are there teams that are a little bit more physical than the Rangers? Yeah, probably. But I don't think it's by such a margin that, you know, that's going to kill the Rangers come playoff time. That they're going to be up against, like, you know, any of these teams that they could play in the first round. Could be Tampa, could be the Caps, could be the Flyers, could be, you know, the Islanders could still get in. A couple other teams as well. I think Detroit is still kind of in the mix, so it could be them as well. But are any of those teams going to just push the Rangers all over the rink? I don't see that. So we'll see how it all shakes out. But again, I think that's been a little bit overstated, the idea that the Rangers have no toughness and have no grit. I don't think they're an easy team to play against when it comes to that department. And lastly, this one isn't so much about the Rangers as much as it's about, you know, the entire NHL. I mean, it's about the Rangers in the fact that the Rangers are in contention for the President's Trophy. But there's been kind of a growing myth in recent seasons that the President's Trophy is indeed cursed. And I decided to kind of look this up for myself and just kind of see, like, okay, how many teams have won the Stanley Cup after winning the President's Trophy? How many teams have really, you know, kind of gone down hard, you know, early in the playoffs after winning the President's Trophy? So the first thing I saw, and this is probably where this rumor comes from, the idea that the President's Trophy is cursed, is that the President's Trophy winners in recent seasons have not done very well. No team that has won the President's Trophy in the past 10 seasons has ever even made it to the Stanley Cup Finals, let alone won it. So that's probably where this idea comes from. In recent years, the President's Trophy winners have not really done all that great. However, the President's Trophy in its history has been awarded now 37 times, and 8 of those teams have won the Stanley Cup, and that includes the 1994 New York Rangers. So that's basically, if we do some rounding here, that's basically 22% of teams that have won the President's Trophy have gone on to win the Stanley Cup. Now, that might not sound like an enormous total, but you got to keep in mind, there's 16 teams in the playoffs every year. The President's Trophy can only be won by one of those teams. And the Stanley Cup playoffs, as we've mentioned many times, are more wide open, I would argue, than probably any other sport when it comes to playoff time. I really do believe if you get in, you've at least got a shot at it. So the fact that almost a quarter of the President's Trophy winning teams have gone on to win the Stanley Cup, that would suggest evidence to the contrary that this President's Trophy is indeed not cursed. Look, I mean, every team, whether you win the President's Trophy or not, you got to get through 4 grueling best of sevens if you want to be the last team standing. And the fact that, again, almost a quarter of the teams has accomplished that feat, that would tell me that the trophy probably is not cursed. On the flip side, though, you know, we'll acknowledge the other side of this as well. 8 of the teams have also, President's Trophy winning teams, 8 of them have been knocked out in the first round, although that has only happened twice in the past 11 seasons. So it's not a very common occurrence, especially recently. I understand superstitions, but I would again argue that this trophy is not nearly as cursed as it is cracked up to be. I have no issues with the Rangers winning it. I'm not afraid of it. And I tend to be kind of superstitious when it comes to sports. The everydayers kind of know that. You know what? Go out and get the President's Trophy. Know that you're going to have home ice advantage through the whole thing. Know that you're the top dog. And know that, you know, nobody's going to mess with you. You're the best team. I mean, that would suggest if you win the President's Trophy, you're the best team in the league. You're the best equipped for the playoffs, and you're ready to go win yourselves a championship. That's a challenge that should be embraced, not shied away from. I see some people, you know, kind of hoping that the Canes will jump the Rangers in the standings, and that way the Rangers will play the Flyers as opposed to potentially Tampa. I get that to an extent. I do. You know, Tampa Bay, again, they've got that championship pedigree, some unbelievable players. They're certainly dangerous in the playoffs. If that happens, I'm not going to cry about it, but by that same token, I want to see the Rangers do as well as possible. The Rangers have to become comfortable in the role of we're the big dog in the yard now. You know, I mentioned earlier ago that run they had through the playoffs 2 years ago, and it just felt like the Rangers, when they were kind of looked at as the better team or they had a lead in the series, you know, whatever the case might have been, that's when they kind of struggled a little bit. They seemed to like going with that like bulldog, underdog kind of mentality where nobody really thinks they're going to win, and that's when they're at their best. But now, with the season they've had, all the winning they've done. I mean, other than January, this has been a phenomenal season for the Rangers. So they got to become comfortable with, okay, we're the bad boys of this league. You know, we're the top dog in the yard. We're the big dog in the yard, and nobody's going to beat us. I want the Rangers to become comfortable with that. And I think winning that President's Trophy, that's kind of just a call to arms. It just kind of, you know, validates their season, and it sets them up to have that mentality throughout the entire Stanley Cup playoffs. You know, we'll see how it goes, but yeah, give me the President's Trophy. I think it would be a really cool accolade, and you know, hopefully the Rangers can do what they did 30 years ago, win the President's Trophy, then go out and win the Stanley Cup. But time is going to tell on that one. Only other thing I want to mention real quick before we call it here, Erik Gustafsson, day-to-day with an upper body injury. So if he and Trouba and Lindgren all miss this game on Tuesday, then you're probably looking at Brandon Scanlon getting into a game. You know, he's been a healthy scratch for the Rangers the last handful of games. You know, we'll see how it goes. But obviously, we hope that, you know, the Ranger defenseman can get healthy and get back before the playoffs. I mean, it sounds like the only one that's in danger of missing any playoff games right now is Ryan Lindgren. And obviously, we hope that doesn't happen. But it sounds like Gustafsson day-to-day seems pretty minor. And Trouba expected back before long as well. We'll see how that goes, though. But once again, thank you guys, as always, for tuning in to the Locked On New York Ranger podcast, your team every day. If you would like to get in touch with this podcast, please send an email to LockedOnNYRangers@gmail.com. Once again, that is LockedOnNYRangers@gmail.com. Definitely give us a follow on Twitter as well, @LO_NY_Rangers. Once again, that is @LO_NY_Rangers. And definitely subscribe to Locked On New York Rangers YouTube channel. Thanks again, guys. I will see you next time.